ladies and gentlemen, almost afternoon by about 30 seconds. Welcome to today's Washington County Public Affairs Forum, where we have an absolutely wonderful presentation, but you're going to have to listen to me for just a couple of minutes before we get to somebody who can truly handle this microphone. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing I just want to flag you to is we're having some really interesting things with our microphone system picking up things, and if you can kill your cell phones, that'd be great. It may have a negative impact on the sound quality. So that'd be cool if you could do that. Wanted to recognize Steve Buckstein, who renewed his membership today. Thank you, Steve.
Yay!
And it's interesting. We're growing exponentially, but that's two things come out of that exponential growth. Folks, the people that are here right now, some of you are regulars, some of you are maybe even one or two of you are new, and some of you come frequently. I was just wondering, our board's been talking. How many people want to continue this time of meeting, noon Mondays? We're having some people saying, are you kidding? We're here all the time. Don't you dare change. We're having other people saying, you know, we'd love to come, but we can't come unless it's evening. So in order to not take too much of our time here, I would like those of you that are sitting with membership badges to raise your hand if you want us to continue Mondays at noon. Thank you. That's a great picture, and I really sincerely appreciate the feedback. The other thing I want to tell you is, over the weekend, two of members, actually one of them was me, and the other one was our Resistant to Change executive director. But at any rate, he just told me he was. I'm not actually saying that. He said he was resistant to change. But we went out and put some wonderful door hangers, and I think you know what I'm talking about. Most of you have seen them, then they're on the desk out there at the front. We put some door hangers on some 250 or so, maybe 300 doors. We expected to have 300 new people come here, but a little low today. And thank you. This is the door hanger we're talking about. Now, the reason I'm saying this to you is most of us, when we get to be my age or a little older, don't get enough exercise. Saturday, December 5th, 1 p.m., meet here. Those of you that can, that are interested, we're going to go out and get a little exercise and drop a number of these on some door hangers. What do they say? They tell people who we are, what we do, how long we've been doing it, and we invite them to join us. Sadly, they will miss our presentation today because I'm sure it will be one of our best. Ladies and gentlemen, without any more comments from me, Labor Commissioner Brad Avakian.
Well, thank you very much for that, Rob. And following up on what you just said, I would encourage anybody who's out there listening to come and join the forum, too. This is the place in Washington County where you can get terrific information about what's going on, not just at the local level, but at the state and national level, too. It is a tradition out here in Washington County, and I can't tell you how pleased I am that you've asked me to come spend the afternoon with you again. Thanks, Rob. I'm Brad Avakian, and I'm the Commissioner of Labor and Industries for the Bureau of Labor and Industries for the state of Oregon. And I thought it would take just a minute and remind you all exactly what we do at the Bureau, but then I want to just update you on a few things that I'm working on as your Labor Commissioner that we know will not only help protect Oregon's workers and keep people free from discrimination, but add jobs and grow our economy in Oregon as well. At the Bureau of Labor and Industries, we do primarily four different things. We enforce the state's wage and hour laws, so we make sure that people get paid every dime that they've earned, that they're getting their meal and rest periods as they should on the job. And also enforce all of the state's civil rights laws. So we keep people free from discrimination on the job, but also do all of the state and federal housing discrimination investigations and any discrimination that may occur in a public place, like a restaurant or a bowling alley or a public park. We keep people free from discrimination in all those public settings as well. And then on the other side of the agency, we have the state's apprenticeship training division. We have a very large hand in the state's workforce development system, making sure that Oregon has got terrific trained workers in the state's Technical Assistance for Employers program. Now, this is our face to Oregon's business community, helping them to be successful by helping businesses navigate their way through complicated state and federal laws. And just to give you an idea of the scope of that work, that technical assistance program gets between 25 and 30,000 calls a year from Oregon businesses just looking for help to understand the law and make sure that they stay within it. And in the last year, we trained approximately 4,000 managers in Oregon's businesses in order to help them be successful as well. But let me take just a minute and put a face on it for you, going back to that side of the agency that protects people on the job. I want you to know a little bit about the kind of people that we help. Not long ago, I met an African-American machinist at the Daimler plant in Portland. This was a person who had worked there for decades, was a very skilled craftsperson in what he did, had earned a terrific living for himself and his family at that company. And one day, in leaving the shop floor and making his way to the parking lot to go home, was met in the parking lot by a group of co-workers standing in the back of the pickup truck with a noose, threatening to drag him around the parking lot. It was unfortunate, but racial epithets, retaliatory job assignments, threats of physical harm like that littered the workplace. In 21st century Oregon, it's hard to imagine that we can still have that 1930s style oppression, but we know that it exists. And the more we investigated, the more we found that it not only had existed for him, but for a number of employees, sometimes dating back close to 20 years. So we went in with our prosecution team, and in one of the largest settlements of its kind, Daimler agreed to pay $2.4 million to its workers. And is now being supervised by the Bureau of Labor for the next 3 years. At the same time that case was going on, we also had a babysitter come to us who had been shorted about $300 from the couple that she was babysitting for. It doesn't matter who you are or who you work for. Everybody that performs work in Oregon has the right to be paid every dime that they've earned. We made sure that that babysitter got her money too. Those are the type of folks that we help at the Bureau. We also have to remember our lowest wage earners in Oregon. I was at a place not long ago. It's not in Washington County, it's in Bend, but we have very similar places right here in Washington County, a place called the Family Kitchen. You should stop there if you ever have a chance to travel through Bend. It's a remarkable place. They serve about 5,000 meals a month to folks that are hungry, that need a place to get warm for a little bit. I asked them who it was that they served. They told me about a veterans camp that was right outside of town, and the veterans that are homeless come in just to find a place to get a good, healthy meal to eat. Bend has a large transient teen population, and so the young people come in just to get warm and to have something to eat, too. It's a tremendous facility that takes care of a lot of people, but it is indicative of a great problem that we have in Oregon right now, and that is, one, we don't have enough jobs for folks, and two, we have a minimum wage for those that are our lowest wage earners that is below the poverty line, just like every other state's minimum wage. If we raised the minimum wage to just above the poverty line for a family of four, that would give about 500,000 Oregonians a raise, and it would pump about $250 million of additional consumer purchasing power into local economies as people buy food and gasoline and school supplies for their kids. A strong minimum wage is necessary, and it's good for Oregon's families. But it's also good for Oregon's businesses. When I travel the state, there are many businesses that tell me that they are concerned that as our poverty class grows, and as our wealthy class grows, and we lose middle income jobs, it forces people down into these minimum wage jobs, and that folks just are not going to have enough money to continue buying the goods and services that local businesses sell. And so what many businesses are concerned about is the loss of consumer purchasing power. I think it's time for us to boost our economy with that additional consumer purchasing power and help lift every family out of poverty by raising our minimum wage now. And I'll be encouraging the legislature when they come back in February to do exactly that. Another thing that businesses tell me as I travel the state is that they are very concerned about where they're going to find their locally skilled workers. They don't necessarily trust Oregon's training programs. They've seen the loss of career education programs in our middle schools and high schools over the year. Oftentimes companies are looking to out-of-state sources in order to bring workers in to perform services and build the goods that they sell. And folks are concerned about a good local workforce that's homegrown right here in Oregon. And I understand their concern. Because of our disinvestment in training programs over the last two decades. But you know that one of my top priorities as your labor commissioner has been to see the return of 21st century shop classes to Oregon's middle schools and high schools. And I wanted to give you an update on that terrific effort. Let me tell you this first. Another one of the reasons why I think it's so important we bring these back. Businesses are not just seeing a lack of local skilled workers. They're also seeing the age of their workers increase. When you look at just the construction trades, although we see this in a lot of industry sectors, your plumbers, your electricians, your cement masons and carpenters and so on, folks are in their late 40s to early 50s. The average age within those trades. But we don't see people coming up at a younger age to replace them. So we have a great concern about how old our workforce is getting. If you look at our community college system in Oregon, the average age of community college student has risen into the late 20s. In the apprenticeship programs that we certify through the Bureau of Labor, there was a day when the average age was 19, the perfect age to get skilled up for a great career. Today, the average age is about 27 and a half. And we attribute all of that to the loss of these middle and high school programs that students are graduating or they're dropping out, they're bouncing around for 6-8 years sometimes before they find themselves back into a training program or on a career path. So we knew that it was important to see the return of these middle school and high school 21st century shop classes. In the last 2 years, because of the grant fund that we helped create in the Department of Education, we've seen these programs restored to over 200 middle schools and high schools in the state of Oregon. That's new career education to over 100,000 students in our state. It was a terrific first step forward. Now, when I say 21st century shop class, I know that it brings up images of wood shop and metal shop and welding, and the truth is those programs are coming back and we need them to come back. But we're talking about some 21st century types of technologies too. Joseph, Oregon, way up in the northeast corner of the state, is doing advanced computer-aided design. Silverton is doing pre-med and sports medicine. Right here in Beaverton, the Beaverton School District is doing biomedical engineering. These were their 21st century shop classes. And I wanted to tell you about a program that I just visited not long ago in clean energy technologies. In this program, the students in the first part of the class, they study advanced computer-aided design, and they actually design an electric vehicle. And then they move to the middle part of the class, where they go to the shop and they learn how to weld. And they actually build the frame and the body of a car. And then they go to the third part of the class, where they learn study advanced physics. And they're learning propulsion systems and braking systems. They assemble an electric motor and they install it in the frame that they built. And at the end of the class, every student has a functioning electric vehicle that they have built from scratch. Well, it isn't really the end of the class, because then I understand they take them all down to the local track and they race them. But this is the face of the 21st century shop class today. It's going to provide a great, well-rounded education for students. It is going to eventually provide a terrific, locally skilled workforce for Oregon's employers. And even more than that, it fulfills the real intent behind our effort to bring these back, which is not just to pump out good little worker bees from Oregon's public school system. It's to make sure that we broaden the horizons of our students in every way possible, that they get a well-rounded education that helps develop them into well-rounded citizens. And we know that it's working in that regard too. The average graduation rate in Oregon for a student graduating on time in 4 years, we know is only about 67 to 70%, one of the lowest in the country. But for students that participate in these types of career education classes, it's over 91% graduate on time in 4 years. So we know that the program has tremendous value just to the development of our young Oregonians. And I have to tell you, when we're done bringing these shop classes back to the middle schools and high schools, I think the next thing we need to do is the same exact thing with music, art, and civics education for every middle and high school student in Oregon. I wanted to give you an update too on the workforce training that we're doing in our apprenticeship programs. Now, most of these programs are devoted to the construction trades. There are a few other types of industry sectors that are represented there as well. But in recent years, we, through our certified apprenticeship programs, have trained over 8,000 individuals for good living wage jobs. And even better than that, there has been an increased focus on bringing people of color and women into these apprenticeship programs in order to make sure that everybody has got a great shot at a job, at a house, and at a good life. In the last legislative session, Senator Chip Shields from Portland advanced a great effort in doubling the amount of money that goes into what's called the Supportive Services Fund. Now, this is a fund that the Bureau of Labor, in partnership with the Department of Transportation, can use in order to help eliminate hurdles and underwrite the cost that of people getting into these types of training programs. Because oftentimes you have to lay out money for tools, for daycare, for transportation, back and forth to a work site. It can become a great hurdle, especially to communities of color and to women. But with that additional money, we've been able to break down more barriers. Right now in Oregon, we have twice the national average of women getting involved in apprenticeship and opening up opportunities for themselves in any number of industry sectors and trades. Oregon is doing a great job of not only advancing a tremendous workforce development system, but making sure that everybody who wants to participate in it has got great access. It really puts us on the pathway to having what I think will eventually be the best workforce development system that you can find anywhere in America and potentially anywhere on the globe. And in doing so, what we really do is give employers that are here in Oregon or that are outside of Oregon and that would like to come here great incentive to be here, because they will have the good locally skilled workers that they need in order to be successful. With that, I know that every time I come to the forum, there is a long, long line of folks with questions, oftentimes going beyond the time that we have, beyond the airtime that we have. And so let me just thank you once again for inviting me to come out and give you an update on what's happening at the Bureau of Labor and Industries, and let you know how nice it is always to come back to my home county that I grew up in, Washington County, and spend a little time with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner, and it's nice to have you home. Questioners, we'll line up right over there. Please feel free to start the line going. And as a reminder, only paid-up members of the forum can ask questions. So those of you that haven't renewed your membership or haven't taken out your membership, I'm sorry. You might catch the commissioner on his way out, but it'd be much more effective here when you have your membership. Thanks an awful lot. I believe we have our first questioner. Steve, go right ahead.
Thank you, Commissioner. Steve Buckstein, forum member. I was interested to know your statistics that construction workers, the average age now is four, excuse me. Oh, I think we lost the mic. There, okay. Was in the 40s or 50s. I wonder if you've considered that by raising the minimum wage, low skill, low income, oftentimes younger workers will find it even harder to get into those skilled jobs, and if the average age of construction workers might rise. So actually there's a downside in my view to raising the minimum wage for the kind of people who cannot justify those high wages, especially in construction work, if there's any consideration that there will be some losers in that.
It's just not what Oregon's experience has been, and it's important to look at the profile of who the minimum wage worker is in Oregon today. The minimum wage worker is not typically a high school student working a few hours after school to earn pocket change. Today's minimum wage worker is likely a woman in her 30s and oftentimes with a family at home. And so the experience from Oregon's last reform with the minimum wage in 2002, when we tied it to the Consumer Price Index and increased it, was actually not that we saw a decrease in available jobs or opportunities, but that actually we saw an increase in the number of small businesses that opened in Oregon, and thank goodness provided more money for especially working women and families, since that is the likely profile of a minimum wage worker today.
Hello, Brad. Thank you so much for coming and sharing with us what's going on with bullying. I have a question regarding unions. We have at least three, I know, of union shops who provide real excellent opportunities for our workers. That'd be the plumbers and steam fitters, our electricians, and the carpenters. There may be others that I don't know about, but I'd certainly like to learn about them. But do you have any involvement with the unions yourself?
As labor commissioner, you would maybe assume that we are highly involved with labor relations between management and with unions. The truth is that that when there's a collective bargaining agreement, that collective bargaining agreement is the relationship between that employer and that set of workers. So in that sense, not as much. However, we are very, very closely involved with the both union and non-union apprenticeship training facilities. And folks should know, you mentioned just three of them, John. I think you mentioned the electricians, the plumbers, and the carpenters. There are a host of other union training facilities, the cement masons, the operating engineers, virtually every craft that you could think of has got a training program. And if you ever have a chance to visit one of these union apprenticeship programs in Oregon, do it, because they are some of the best training facilities on earth right here in our state. If you, for instance, want to be a licensed electrician, there is nowhere on earth you can go that would be better to be a trained, licensed electrician than the IBEW training facilities in Portland and the rest of the state. The same is true for Local 290 plumbers and pipe fitters in Tualatin, one of the best training facilities that you could find anywhere if that's the craft you want to go into. I regularly, as labor commissioner, spend time in those facilities talking to apprentices, talking to journey workers, and my team at the Bureau of Labor and Industries makes sure, because this is our role in that, make sure that all of the standards are being met in order to graduate the kind of skilled journey workers that we need to support Oregon's industries and Oregon's families both. So in that respect, we have a very close relationship both with the union and the non-union training facilities.
Jim Cape, for a member. In the modern workplace, is there such a thing as artistic license, where an artist gets to choose what patron they decide to work for? And when businesses post a sign that say, we reserve the right to refuse service to anyone, is that a valid sign? Thank you.
I think we're now talking about wedding cakes. Jim, let me take the second part of your question first, and I think the second part of your question was it the we refuse the right to serve anybody? Businesses in Oregon do have the right to refuse service to people. You're a private business, but there are exceptions to that, and the exceptions are that you cannot discriminate against people based on their race, their religion, their gender, their sexual orientation, and the like. If you are not discriminating based on one of those protected classes, then you do have the right to refuse service for other reasons. But that's where the line is drawn. And we get cases at the Bureau where individuals have denied service based on either a personal like or dislike, or based on what they believe is a closely held religious belief, or for some other reason. But none of those are a reason for discriminating against somebody because of their protected class. Everybody in society has the right to believe what they want to believe. That is a freedom that I cherish. However, you do not have the right to use that belief in order to prevent people, because of who they are, from equally entering the marketplace. When a business opens its doors to the public, then it has to respect that people, that everybody has got the right to come in free from discrimination based on their protected class status and participate in the marketplace, including at your business.
Hi, Rob Solomon, for a member. Two-part question. The first one is, how many states, if you know, have a position similar to labor commissioner? It's my understanding it wouldn't be many.
No, virtually all of the states, I think, have a labor commissioner. There are only four of them that elect their labor commissioner like Oregon does.
Okay. Second part would be, seeing as how you've served in the position for a long time, could you give us two or three of the accomplishments that you're most proud of?
You know, pride is an interesting word. There's things that I'm very glad that the Bureau has been involved in or that it's accomplished, but I have to tell you, the folks that work at the Bureau of Labor and Industries are dedicated to a mission, to making sure that everybody has got a good shot at life, and it is a team effort there. There are a few things in particular that was just so pleased to see happen. One of them is our efforts to return these shop classes to the middle schools and high schools. When I go to these schools and I see the things that these students are creating, the hope and the excitement that it generates in them for what they could do for the rest of their lives, the fact that some of the students in that class I know would have been part of that 33% that didn't graduate on time in 4 years, and now they're going to graduate on time in 4 years, and like a few of them that I saw when I spoke at the Oregon City High School's program, their graduation last year, graduated not only with their high school diploma, but on graduation day had nearly enough credits for an associate's degree from Clackamas Community College. So it has been very fulfilling to me, and I know that it has been a remarkable thing for the students, for the teachers, and for the parents that are involved in these programs to see those come back. Another was the story of Lieutenant Colonel Linda Campbell. And this actually was not a case that was filed with the Bureau that went for the Bureau, or went through the Bureau, but it was something I just knew was important for us to be involved in and to assert ourselves in. Linda Campbell is a retired colonel from the Air Force, had a career in the Oregon Air Guard as well. And I was on the phone with her one day. I had not met her before. She said, you know, I know as labor commissioner there's probably not much you can do about this, but I want you to know my story. And she said, I have a same-sex spouse, Nancy Lynn Child. Nancy is dying of breast cancer. And it had always been our hope that we could be buried together at Willamette National Cemetery, where my father is buried. She wanted to be buried with her father. They had a family legacy of service to our country. And she also had her life partner, the love of her life, who she wanted to be buried as well. But had been told by the federal government that because they were a same-sex couple, that they could not be buried together there. And she was left with the unbelievably terrible decision of, do I continue my family's legacy and be buried in the military cemetery with my father, or do I give that up and Nancy and I be buried together? And it was, she said, I know there's nothing you can do about that because it's federal law. And I said, don't you be so sure. And we partnered with Nancy and with Linda on an effort to change the federal policy to allow Nancy, when she died of the cancer, to be buried in Willamette National Cemetery, and someday when it was Linda's time, for her to be buried alongside the person she loved and her family together. I only wish the decision had been made before Nancy died. But several months after Nancy died, the White House agreed to do, for the first time in the nation's history, something that they had never done before, and that was to allow a same-sex couple to be buried together in a national cemetery. There are many other smaller stories that strike at my heart as well, like that babysitter that was shorted $300. But those two in particular are close to my heart.
Harry Bodine, forum member. Brad, thanks for coming. I really was happy about your statements about the shop classes coming back. I think that's really a critical change that state needs. I don't want to beat the dead horse, but I want to go back to sweet cakes for just a second. I understand the law, and I understand that the couple violated the law, so they had to receive a penalty. It's the penalty I want to ask you about. $150,000. I'm looking around this room, and how many people in here could sustain a $150,000 fine? In our case, our household has 3 years annual income. So what was the business closed? How many employees do they have that lost their jobs? And where is the status? Why the 150? And just what was the rationale? And it's almost like the state of Oregon wants to destroy these people. Your response, please.
Well, just to add a little bit to what Harry's asking me about, he's asking me again about the Sweet Cakes decision, which was the bakery that denied service to a lesbian couple when they came in and asked for a wedding cake. And there are some things about the case I'm not going to talk about because it's currently on appeal, so it's not done yet. But you asked me a question about what the reasoning was behind, and I'm happy to talk some about that. Let me clarify first that the award in the case was not a fine. In a civil rights case, I don't have the authority to fine a business, to penalize them for what they did. You can think of the process more like when somebody is harmed and they go to court and they have to prove their harm. They have to prove damages. And then the Bureau can award damages to the individual based on the evidence that was provided at the hearing, which is different than just saying you broke the law, I'm going to penalize you in a dollar amount. If for instance, I had found that the law had been broken, but that the couple had not proven damages, then there would have been no monetary award. In this particular case, there were two parts to the award. One was the monetary amount based on the evidence that was provided of the emotional harm that was caused by the denial. And the second was my order that the individuals refrain from discriminating again in the future or from letting the world know by publicizing or stating publicly in some way that they were going to discriminate. Both of those are violations of Oregon's law. So the dollar amount was reached by the evidence that was proven at hearing of the harm that had been caused. The judge, the administrative law judge that hears the case in what we call a hearing similar to a trial, recommended to me, I think the amount was $140,000 in damages for the emotional harm that was caused. And then I, as labor commissioner, can adopt that, reject it, modify it. I made the decision after reading the transcript to adopt the award. And in brief, my reasoning was this. It's easy to think that the case is simply the denial of a cake, and that in being denied you can just walk down the street and buy another cake, and I guess physically that's something you can do. But anytime somebody's told you do not have the ability to enter the marketplace on equal footing with everybody else that has the right to go into any shop that's open to the public and participate, you're denying them more than just the one product. You're denying them equal access to society. And that can have a stinging, deep, and lasting effect on somebody when they know that's the way they are viewed by people in the marketplace. And I was convinced that the evidence that was presented at the hearing supported the fact that that was the deeply felt harm from these individuals, and it was for that reason that I supported the recommendation on the monetary award.
Thank you for your explanation.
And I'll add one more thing, just because you threw it in on the closure of the business. To my knowledge, the business is not closed. I think the individuals that own the business shut down their brick and mortar place and is operating it out of their home. It is never the intent to shut down a business, but it is my obligation to make sure that citizens in Oregon are kept free from discrimination.
Karen Bolin, I'm a small business owner here in Aloha. I hired a woman that had no experience other than retail and a GED, fit your description, paid her $12 an hour. After 90 days of her showing up on time, learning what I had to teach her, and then contributing to the business, I gave her a dollar an hour raise. My concern with making the raise too much, too soon, is we're not making young people earn the right to get to a certain level. I'm young meaning 30, okay? I mean, they chose their path. I have to train them. The day one they come in, they can't do a lot for my business. So I have to invest in them. So could it not be where you pay them a minimum wage, maybe after it, 90 days, or not a minimum wage, but a higher wage, after they have a trainee time? So you can hire young people, meaning 30, pay them a certain level. I don't know, what's your proposal for the dollar amount? Do you have a number? Like your minimum wage number per hour, is it $12 or $15?
Well, there were four different bills at the legislature mm-hmm. last year that ranged from a little above $12 to $15 an hour. And I know there are currently two efforts out there now, one at $13.50 an hour and one at $15. But we'll see what it is that the legislature decides to take up. My position is that it should be above the poverty line for a family of four, mm-hmm. which we think in the year 2017 will be slightly above $12 an hour.
So I, as a business owner, would not hire at that level, but after they've done their 90 days and contributed and liked the job and know I'm going to stay, I would be willing to give them a raise. Then the second thing is, after they complete a year with me, I can add in health care, like company-paid health care. But I've already made the investment of a year, they've contributed back, so now I'm ready to invest more. So I think as we talk about giving them hard cash in their hand, if we could alleviate the burden of maybe a higher expense, which is their health care for them and their family, and I as a business get a tax deduction for having covered that for my employees, right? So I'm not giving them hard cash, but I'm covering a very large risk factor. So couldn't it be 90 days they get a raise, a year they get health insurance, 2 years they get something? I mean, couldn't we talk about other things other than just hard cash? Then the second thing is, before music, art, and civics, I would like to see us put in personal finance, which used to be in home economics and isn't anymore. So there you go.
Well, last one first. I agree, and I see that type of a class as part of the kind of thing that I'm talking
That's
about.
That's next.
And well, exactly. We need to see those programs come back. Matter of fact, the Portland Public School District, with the grant money it received for shop classes, chose to institute a program in 52 of its schools that was more of a life skills type of a class, right down to things like, what does it mean when the alarm goes off at 5:30 in the morning? You got to get to work on time if you want to get a paycheck, right? As well as, you know, personal budgeting and writing resumes and things like that. Karen, I think you're spot on.
Thank you.
We need to be raising well-rounded human beings that are capable of taking on anything in life. With the first part of your question, there are lots of ideas about how to form a minimum wage. I've been very clear that there are some things I do not support. I do not support a tip credit. Tip credit, of course, is when you take workers primarily in the restaurant industry that get tips, and you can decrease their hourly wage by the amount that they get in tips, so that they end up oftentimes earning the minimum wage because they have to offset their tips. And the other is a training wage, where you're able to pay somebody less during some type of a training period before they move up to the minimum wage. I don't support that either. I believe that we need to have a wage in Oregon that is above the poverty line. I want Oregon to be the state that says we are not going to have hardworking people that are taking care of families living in poverty. Now, as somebody who ran his own business for 15 years, Karen, I am very sympathetic to the pressures of running a business, to making a payroll every 2 weeks, to the immense cost of providing health care for your employees, and the fact that you can invest so much in time and money and effort and in relationship with folks that maybe end up don't staying. And I know that's an issue for a lot of businesses, and especially some industry sectors over others, and it's an issue maybe we need to address. But I'm not in favor of a wage that is lower than the minimum wage during those training periods.
Lee Coleman, forum member. Welcome back home, Commissioner.
Thank you, Lee.
I hear a wild rumor that you're running for the Secretary of State position in a primary. What is your vision for that office? If you care to comment.
Well, I appreciate the question, Lee. I want to be very respectful to my opponents in the race and to the forum. I did not come here as a candidate today. I came here to talk to you about my position as Labor Commissioner. I also don't want to disrespect your question, Lee. So let me answer it this way. It has been one of the greatest privileges of my life serving as your Labor Commissioner. Getting up every morning with two things in mind: how do I help Oregon businesses be more successful, and how do I make life a little bit better for Oregon's workers? And I look at that Secretary of State position, and I know that there is so much we can do to advance a clean energy economy through the Lands Board, to do what I did with shop classes as Labor Commissioner, with civics education as Secretary of State. And so I see it as a continuation of my public service, Lee. And let me just save the rest of it to the time when hopefully this forum invites me and my two opponents in this race to come back all together.
We'll have you back, sir.
Hi, Phil Nelson, forum member. Thank you for coming. I have a question about finances in terms of the apparent disinvestment, we might say, of Oregon in higher ed. The post-high school education system seems to be constantly in need of more money. And do you see any prospect or have any ideas for how that might be rectified through particularly higher taxes? Is there any hope here? Thank you.
Phil, you ask a fair question about Oregon's tax structure, but let me take a step back from it before we get to that piece of it. And I speak not just from somebody who understands Oregon's budgeting system very well. I served for a time on the Ways and Means Committee when I was in the state legislature. I pay very close attention to what's happening in higher ed and K through 12 both now. And I just have, two children that just graduated from college.
Woo-hoo.
So, they unfortunately are living in New York. They're both theater kids, and my son's a composer and musician, and it did rip my heart out to have them be so far away, but I'm so happy for what they're doing. But I understand the immense burden college places on a family. And let me tell you this, in all sincerity and a belief that someday it needs to be this way: college should be free.
Here, here.
No, yes.
That is not some pie-in-the-sky ideal. It's deeply rooted in American ideals and tradition. We created the public school system so that everybody who had the ability and willingness to learn had access to education and therefore could become well-educated citizens who participated in the democratic process and supported the democracy. And in addition, supported the economy. In order to have equal access for every person like I just described, it must be free. And not only do we not have, or are we far from a free education in the college level, but it's not free in K through 12 anymore. You want to play on a football team? Cough up $250. You want to be a cheerleader at your high school? There's $1,000 wrapped up in all the various things they need to do. Maybe it's $90 for your fee for the science class for the materials. If you're a teacher in the public school system, you better plan on coughing up $600 to $800 every year to buy basic school supplies for your classroom. It is not free. And what we are ending up with is a society that is becoming more and more segregated based on wealth, where those that have the ability to afford education get a head start in life, and those that don't struggle. So the first real answer to your question is, we have got to cut out this nonsense that our public institutions are some type of profit center, and we got to get back to understanding that there are places of education that need to be equally accessible by everybody. Now, given that, you ask a question that relates not just to higher ed, but to a lot of public services, and that is, what are we going to do about creating a revenue stream for the state that adequately supports the services that are necessary? The state does not have enough money right now. We're over $2 billion under the quality education model for K through 12, and we are so far behind, you can't even hardly quantify it with regard to higher education. One of the answers has got to be that Oregon corporations and foreign corporations that do business here have got to contribute more than they're contributing. The corporations today pay less in taxes, and this is accounting for inflation, than they did under Ronald Reagan and Tom McCall, for gosh sake. We need a greater balance. We need to take the burden off middle class families and poor people, and we've got to have more of an equal share of contribution from corporations that do business in Oregon. That's part of the answer.
Chris Leslie, foreign member. I'm sort of the school that raising the minimum wage also raises inflation. And being on a fixed salary, I feel that that's a threat. And I'm going to cause a little stir the pot a little bit. What are the demographics for really minimum wage workers? Aren't they usually high school students, people that aren't poor member families? Do you have the figures on that?
The typical profile for a minimum wage worker is not a high school student working, you know, part-time after school like we think of them. We know that about 62% of minimum wage workers are women over the age of 30, and we know that many of those have families. As we have lost manufacturing in America and in Oregon in particular, as we've lost the many thousands of middle-class jobs that came from that industry sector, adults have been pushed down into the minimum wage jobs and young people out. And so the typical profile today is that you're likely a woman in her 30s and possibly with a family at home.
I'm Bill Kroger, foreign member. Thanks for coming in, Brad. Appreciate it. You're always entertaining and always very knowledgeable. I'm somewhat irritated at our federal Justice Department for not going after individuals that may have caused the Great Recession that we had. They went after corporations with fines and things. You talked about the black employee at Daimler who, and that Daimler ended up getting fined. I was just kind of wondering what your thought was personally. I feel that if the justice system in the state or federal or whatever level goes after individuals causing problems, then maybe people in the future will think twice about that. And I was just kind of wondering what your thoughts were about that and if in fact Boley does anything like that.
Well, let me just nuance part of your question there, just because it is an important point, not just for lawyers and judges, but the Daimler was not a fine. I do not fine businesses who violate civil rights laws. Money is awarded for damages that are proven. And if damages are not proven, nobody gets anything. In the Daimler case, neither of those things happened. Daimler stepped up to the plate and said, we think some things happened here that shouldn't have happened. Boley, come in and help us. We're going to create a fund to take care of the workers that were harmed. And $2.4 million was what we had all agreed to. With respect to your broader question, Bill, about going after wrongdoers, when it involves areas of violations of wage and hour law or civil rights law, then it is my job to make sure that wrongdoers are held accountable. And we do that, and we do it aggressively. We've prosecuted more cases, and we've collected more money for workers than at any time in the history of the Bureau of Labor and Industries. But there's a reason why we do it, and it is not just to protect the worker. But it's also because if you're a business that's out there and you do play by the rules, you go the extra mile for your workers, you should not have to be competing on a playing field that isn't level because you're competing against workers or employers that are skirting the rules, that are artificially decreasing their labor costs because they rip their workers off. And so a strong system of enforcement is good for both the workers you protect and for the employers that play by the rules and deserve a level playing field. And that's the way I've approached my job as labor commissioner.
Phil Nelson again, forum member. Hope you don't mind another question, but I'm wondering about the trade agreement, the Asian trade agreement, TPP. Does the Bureau have a position on that, or do you, or would you care to comment about it and how you feel about it?
No, I appreciate the question. This, of course, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and I'll mention other similar types of so-called free trade agreements. The states have virtually no direct role in them. I don't, as a labor commissioner, have a vote in whether the Trans-Pacific Partnership is going to be passed or not. But I do have very strong opinions about it. We in Oregon are coming to a point now with our workforce training system where I think we can compete with anybody on earth. And we're giving folks opportunities that can, in training, that can get them a good living wage job, that can take care of themselves and their families for life. And what we cannot afford to do now is to pull the rug out from under Oregon's working families by use of these so-called free trade agreements that take a meat axe to American manufacturing and rip middle-class jobs overseas. We have lost millions of jobs nationwide because of trade agreements in the past, and now that we can see the specifics of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, we know the same thing is going to happen again. We're telling the world we're going to give you access to our market in America to sell your goods, and hopefully we're going to get access to your market, but we're going to let you continue building whatever you build and selling it here without having to invest in the type of environmental protections that we invest in here in the United States, or by paying a wage to your workers that allows them to escape poverty. We are creating a playing field that is anything but level for ourselves, and for that reason, Oregon families are going to suffer. I think Congress should reject this ridiculous so-called free trade agreement, and I think it should turn its attention back to infrastructure projects and restoring manufacturing here at home. We're getting close. Yeah. After we're off the air, I'll tell you one more story, if there's time, why I feel so strongly about that.
Perfect. Just a second. We're going to... let me please just take a moment to thank the Commissioner for a wonderful presentation. So good with questions, the line just never ends, and we knew that was going to happen. So before I close off, let me say a couple of quick things. First of all, next week we have the state treasurer, Ted Wheeler, who may or may not be running for something else. I don't pay attention to the media, something like that. But we're looking forward to learning about the Treasury Department. Folks, those two dates, just to remind you, I didn't tell you about one today, I did before. December 5th. Saturday. Come here, and we'll be looking forward to getting that information out and seeing if we can get this room so darn full we have to move to another one. If we do, we'll let you know. Now, folks, the other thing is January 7th. I've said a few times, and in some of the email that you might be getting from me, mark January 7th, 6:30 in the evening, Beaverton Library. What I'm going to tell you today, I won't tell you the topic yet,
But that will be the very first joint program that the Washington County Public Affairs Forum will present with the Portland City Club. And we're very much looking forward to it. We're looking forward to everybody being there. Just one dinner, the rest will be lunches. Once again, Commissioner, thank you very, very much for a good presentation. I know we have one question and one more story coming from you, which may or may not make the camera. Thank you.
Question first.
Harry
Bodine again. Brad, when back in the dark ages, I had a newspaper route at the age of 13, and suddenly I was embarrassingly rich. I was earning a dollar a day, you know. Anyway, part of the problem as I see it today is it's impossible for somebody under the age of 18 to get hired, except by maybe fast food industries. That's the only, basically those jobs have gone away, and you want to hire somebody, you're discouraged from doing it because the age, you're younger than 18. So how do these kids learn how to work?
Great question.
It is a good question, Harry, and I hear this a lot from employers too, and I actually hear it a lot from students too. What I described earlier with the loss of middle class jobs and the forcing of adults down into the minimum wage jobs, and therefore forcing young people out into, you know, whatever else, that is a real dynamic, and everybody is feeling it. We're not going to solve that dynamic until we restore the tens of thousands of middle class jobs that we've lost and we open up the pipeline again. And I do hear from a lot of employers, young people that come in, it's a whole different culture today.
Absolutely.
They don't have the same kind of discipline, they don't have the same loyalty, they don't have the same interest. And I have to tell you, there may be some truth to that, but I think it's not the full part of the story. We're lucky in Oregon to have, I think, a really tremendous business community that for the most part really goes above and beyond in the extra mile for its workers. Now, my enforcement authority exists for the ones that don't do that. But we really have terrific employers that I think want to provide good long-term jobs for young people. But we, in our workforce today, there's not as much loyalty going either way. Companies are quicker to lay people off to save a dime. They're quicker to do something a different way. And there just doesn't seem to be, you were talking about the dark ages, Harry. So I'm going back to the time you were earning a buck a day or whatever it was. But we know that there was a day when there was a much tighter loyalty between a worker and between an employer. And we saw people staying in jobs and employers keeping them in jobs for much longer periods of time. And that, for whatever reason, has broke down on both sides. But with respect to getting young people working again, I believe that young people today, they care about the world, they're interested, they kind of shake their head at Washington, D.C. saying, why would I want to be involved in that? And a lot of them look at employers not as long-term situations, but as short-term situations. So the culture is different, but I think that they are highly intelligent, hardworking young people. The problem is, we don't have jobs for them. We don't have enough jobs for the young people, for the adults, let alone young people. And until we start adding jobs and growing our economy, what you described is never going to be solved. And even worse than that, we're going to continue seeing what we're seeing, which was students getting out of high school, getting out of college, if that's what they do, and then moving somewhere else. Going to California or Colorado or somewhere else. All right, I'll tell you my little story now. It's been several years ago, I took a trip to Taiwan with a delegation of U.S. labor officials. And we were to exchange economic development, workforce development ideas, and during the day, it was neatly dressed tables with flags and very ornate and formal, like you think of when you think of a diplomatic event. And we took turns trading ideas. And then at the end of the day, when that was done, they wanted to go get dinner and drink. They loosened up a lot. And that's when many of the really meaningful conversations happened, was over dinner. And one evening, I was sitting with what is the equivalent of their national press secretary. And he leaned over to me and he said, "You want to know what we really think of you Americans?" And I said, "Sure." And he said, "We think you're a joke." And I'm thinking to myself, okay, you know, we're still the greatest economic power the world has ever known, and still the greatest economic power in the world today. And Taiwan, you're doing great, but that was a bold statement to make. And I said, so I didn't tell him that, but I just thought that. So I said, well, why do you say that? And I'm telling you, what he told me was, I think, one of the most poignant and informative things I have ever heard about where we're at in America and what the world thinks of us.
Perceived.
He said, perceived and in reality. He says, you just keep doing all your research in your universities and keep sending all of your manufacturing to us, because we are a very patient people and someday we will pass you. He sees what's happening in America, like a lot of the world does and like a lot of us do, which is that we are more than willing to let go the industry sector sectors of building things. And what you see happening there in Europe and South America is you see some countries that are starting to create a middle class. They're kind of like where the United States was in the 1930s and 40s. They're starting to create a middle class. They see us with a growing poverty class, a growing ultra-wealthy class, and very little in the middle, and that widening, and they know if they just wait long enough, our economy collapses, they have a strong middle class with the world's manufacturing, and they become the economic engine of the globe. It was a very, very astute thing that he said, and I have never forgotten it. And when it, and it ties into the question of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, because I think that when you combine our trade policies in the United States with our shareholder and tax laws, which almost legally force companies to go find a cheaper labor force somewhere else in the globe in order to increase shareholder profits, what you've done is you have built a system in this country that almost legally forces companies to send middle-class jobs outside of our borders. And that is exactly why we have lost millions and millions of middle-class jobs from this country and have people working for a poverty wage. And that one conversation in Taiwan really hit it home for me. Thanks again for having me out.